Oh, we're live. We are live here on Spaceship Earth. I'm here with Stuart J. Hooper. You want to just record or go live?
All right. Let's see.
Or just give us a minute. We're getting ourselves all situated. There we go. Oh, we lost it. We're doing a little live interview action. We're almost there. Bear with us, people. Got to get his camera set up too. All right. So, see, I don't know if I even need to worry about anyone watching or not. I think it just goes straight to my YouTube channel. Does this go straight to my YouTube channel? We got one thumbs up. All right, let's get into it. So Stuart is from the UK, right?
I'm from Essex in England, which is just above London.
Essex in England. And Stuart's been watching my channel for about 4 years, and he happens to be in Los Angeles. So we figured we would get it done today and do a little interview and chit chat and talk for a while. And because you're studying political science?
Yep, I sure am.
In Albuquerque?
Yep, at the University of New Mexico on their PhD program.
PhD, yeah. Poli-sci. So, but before we get going, Stuart has a YouTube channel. It is?
StuartJ Hooper.
StuartJ Hooper,
yep.
Dude.
You just pull that in, youtube.com/StuartJHooper.
That's why I made it the title.
Yeah, same on Twitter and Facebook as well.
And there's all the stuff. I'll put all that in later. So political science in Albuquerque.
Yep.
So what are you gonna do with political science?
Well, I originally came here to look at the military industrial complex. Mm-hmm. That's what I applied to do. So I was gonna look at that, but recently it's kind of been almost done to death, you could say.
The military industrial complex?
Yeah,
it's been done to death.
Yeah, there are a hell of a lot of people looking at it.
You mean the rubbleizing of Spaceship Earth?
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah. So instead, I've kind of switched what I want to do now for my research project. So last year, I was inspired by Elon Musk, who wants to take humanity to Mars, and he has a legit plan to do it within the next 10 years. So what my new research project is how we govern a human colony on another planet.
I'm not buying into Elon Musk, man.
You don't?
I don't.
How come?
All right, this is my trip on Elon Musk. So he called this stuff Tesla, right?
Mm-hmm.
And he didn't name it after the rock band.
Yeah.
He named it after Nikola Tesla's technology, right?
Mm-hmm.
Where are the Tesla coils?
Yeah.
And he can make me a believer, dude, because my theory is, and I have yet, I still have a little bit of faith in Elon. Mm-hmm. Is that eventually everyone who has a Tesla is going to get a package in the mail one day, and it's going to be their Tesla coil to plug into their Tesla cars.
Right, yeah.
But him investing his time in batteries and solar cells proves to me that he isn't truly dialed in with Nikola Tesla's technology, because Nikola Tesla was that there's enough energy between you and me in the localized energy field to power the planet, dude.
Yeah.
So that tells me, man, he's a sham and he's just using the Tesla technology as a cover for New World Order bullshit.
Yeah, well, I mean, you could say that for sure, especially, like you say, he's working on batteries. Like, that's his big thing, a battery.
Yeah, like,
the thing. But with specifically the space stuff, he has said that he really does not want it to become a profit-making venture, and he wants to get in place a full plan for his succession when he eventually dies in the company, so it continues to not be a profit-making venture. So I think the space stuff...
Well, it's not a profit-making venture right now. The state of California gives them huge subsidies.
Yeah.
I think every employee has, like, cost the state of California, like two or three times what they actually get paid.
Mm-hmm.
Something like that. You would know more than I do.
Yeah, I haven't got into the numbers yet. But
yeah, it's a scam, dude.
Yeah.
And I've driven a Tesla. Have you driven a Tesla?
No, I've never driven a Tesla.
Awesome piece of equipment.
Yeah?
Yeah. I mean, it's pretty radical, dude. Like, you... But, you know, I'm still skeptical, man. Because as long as we're on this, like, power grid thing,
mm-hmm.
I get where he's trying to free it up a little bit, but as long as there's transmission lines involved, it's super inefficient.
Yeah. I mean, it's still, like you were saying, the 1800s technology.
Yeah, cars. Maybe. I like the Hyperloop thing he was talking about.
Yeah. I think he's trying to get that in motion now.
Yeah, good luck in California, man. We're so ass backwards out here. So you're studying basically what politics would look like on a colonization level of Mars.
Yeah. At first, when I brought it to the professors, they were like, that might be a bit of a stretch. But then the more they thought about it, they were like, actually, that's going to happen. That is going to be a legit problem that's going to have to be figured out.
Well, I was listening to one of these crazy dudes. I listen to Steve Quayle guy every now and then, and Steve Quayle was talking about how, like, Mars, and that they're so, that we're going to get woken up to how advanced whatever's going on Mars, like, that they've already been there doing stuff with the jump rooms and the whole, like, I don't know how far you get into that. See, that's what I'm saying is, and we'll get into this. I'm convinced of the mind control that we live in two technologically different civilizations. There's our civilization with these dumb iPhones and Tesla cars and jet planes and and all this stuff. And then there's this advanced civilization on the same planet that has all this technology that's ancient, essentially, dude. That's so much further advanced than we are, that they've already been doing it. Like, I don't buy into the whole VWs from outer space. Like,
yeah, same.
Spaceships, yeah. They don't make any sense to me.
I mean, they still claim that the SR-71 Blackbird is the fastest jet that we currently have on Earth.
Really?
Yeah, and that obviously was built, it's in the name, in 1971. So if you think we haven't advanced since then,
And then you look, I mean, even the space shuttle was German technology from like the 1930s, exactly. You know, like people haven't clued into, like, we're being fed a steady stream of lies and disinformation.
Yeah. I mean, definitely with the energy stuff, there are a lot of interests behind keeping it as it is. Corporate interests, financial interests.
See, and that's all right. And that kind of ties into that. Like, what I don't understand is hoarding the technology just leads to the problem, right? Mm-hmm. Like, to me, there seems to be an organized plan to kill off humanity.
Right.
Because if you're truly paying attention, industrializing and technology lowers populations. It's been proven over and over again. As a good economy, people will have less children and the population will actually decline. You look at like China and Germany, like their populations are dropping to a detrimental level, dude. I mean, look at the US. We need immigrant populations.
It would be the same in Africa if they actually allowed them to industrialize.
Exactly, but they,
instead of saying they can't because of climate change. You might cause climate change so you can't have an industry.
Yeah.
Like Obama going and saying, you can't have a car, you can't have air conditioning, because you might.
And I flew here in a 747 with a bunch of other stuff.
Yeah, I mean, it's just, it's colonization all over again.
Well, you know, you look at it,
through more sophisticated means.
Yes. It's colonialism, yeah. Mm-hmm. It's just, it's a technological colonialism.
Yeah.
And that gets me into the thing is, you know, who was the guy I was listening to was talking about? What's his name, dude? Matt Drudge was talking about how, like, basically we've all been forced into, like, technological ghettos via YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, that really there are these condensed technology ghettos that we're stuck in, that we're missing the huge broadband nature of the internet, and we're stuck in these little spheres.
Yeah, and the real problem with those two specifically, so Instagram and Facebook are the two where they curate the feed for you.
Dude.
And they show you what they think you want to see and obviously stop you from seeing other things.
Oh, yeah. No, so, it's totally censored. Well, it's come out as it's totally being censored.
Mm-hmm.
And that to me is I don't get how, at this point, like, we all need to, like, drop our Facebook feed.
Yeah.
But there's a certain connectivity too.
Yeah, exactly. So you can keep it.
It's a dual-edged sword, man.
Mm-hmm.
But it's definitely being censored. So anyone who thinks that their ideas are being free, like, you're only getting, like, I have a unique Facebook feed, right?
Yeah.
Because I have my viewer thing. So I got thousands of people. I don't know any of them are.
Mm-hmm.
But they all come from different demographics. And you can see the Civil War occurring in live time via Facebook is you will have someone basically calling for the assassination of Trump here, and then someone down here going, dude, like, give this dude a shot, like, let him try that, and then down here going, this guy's an asshole, and then down here, like, hey, you guys are stupid, like, you, it's this thing, and you're like, dude, most people are just speaking to the choir on Facebook. Like, they're like, if they could see my feed, they would be like, dude, we're in some trouble, man. We are in some deep, deep trouble, man.
Like, yeah, I mean, I posted something on the day after Trump won, and it was a news headline with a picture of Vladimir Putin, and it said, Putin ready to reset relations with US and basically send them off in the best direction. That was the news headline from RT. So I posted it up. I was like, this is why everybody should be happy that Trump just got elected, because now we're a little further away from than World War III.
No, apparently they like war, dude.
Yeah. So, and then someone commented on it, and they were like, Trump's a racist. How can he ever prevent World War III? Then I'm like, how, even if he is a racist, what does that have to do with the topic at hand? Absolutely nothing.
Well,
it seems always people just tend to fall back to these...
it's a trigger word.
Yeah, these trigger words.
Dude, you're racist, bro. Now what? You're exactly, white male. Yeah. Now what?
Yeah.
And they know it, dude. Mm-hmm. No, you're part of the problem. Just, yeah. No, dude, you're part of the problem. Stuart.
Yeah, I am part of the problem.
You're white male.
Yeah.
You are part of this. So whatever comes out of you comes from a colonialist, imperial, white male perspective. And it's void, dude. Because we live on an oppressed brown planet, dude, where we... It's up to you to give people their freedoms, dude. Mm-hmm. And you haven't. And historically, dude, everything about you is the problem. So,
yeah, that's
what do you want to talk about? Because whatever you have to say is void.
Yeah.
Because you're a white male.
Mm-hmm. And that is literally the viewpoint that these people have. And it's, how do you have a conversation with somebody like that? You literally
cannot
have a conversation with somebody who is so obsessed with identity politics that they can't see past that and get to the real message and some actual pragmatism. It's ridiculous.
Phil Dog 128 totally agrees.
Yeah, he's totally right.
Well, no, the interesting thing is I posted and I stayed off the. And this is censorship. I won't post on Facebook anymore. Right? Because I don't want it. I don't want to deal with the nonsense, right? Which is lame, dude. I should be like, fuck it, dude. I'm going to post and I don't care. But the vitriol coming out of people afraid to explore ideas is crazy town, right? And I'm just in that. Let's explore the idea. You can't pigeonhole me into any one opinion. Like, I'm morph. I don't know. Give me some new data. So I posted the video of the Asian guy from the Shia LaBeouf cam, right? Oh, yeah. The Asian guy and his black friend and the three other Asian guys and the white guy. They look straight out of the Matrix, right? And he gave that crazy speech. And I was like, wow, this dude kind of breaks it down. Saying the left is ultimately responsible for their own discomfort because they have created this. I'm down with transgenders, dude. My wife's client's transgender. I don't care. I don't care.
No,
I'm a liberal. I'm a liberal.
Somehow with this obsession with identity politics, and this is rampant in political science as well, by the way. So the department is just obsessed with it.
Really?
Yeah. It's just rampant. But we've completely regressed to the time before Martin Luther King.
Yeah.
Martin Luther King had it all right.
Would be embarrassed.
It's the content of your character. Not the color of your skin, not what gender you are. None of that stuff matters at all. It's what is the message coming out of somebody's mouth? That's what you should listen to.
Yeah. Well, you know, Martin Luther King was up against it. He was pretty gnarly, dude. I mean, he knew what... I mean, that's how they killed him. He started to speak out against Vietnam.
Yeah, and we really have regressed... And just seems to have completely forgotten his message, which is a real shame, because I was inspired by him when I was like...
He's the most influential dude in my, like, youth.
Yeah, like when I was about 13 or 14 years old, we would... We had a class on religious ethics, ethics and philosophy, and one of the modules was, like, racism. So obviously he was a big figure in studying that. And yeah, everything he did and his message really resonated with me since then. And... I don't have a clue how we've managed to completely jump over it, essentially.
Well, it's this thing is like, you don't get it because you're an open mind, willing to explore ideas and be proven wrong.
If
the new information shows up and you're like, oh, I can see it from a different perspective. I figure you're sort of like, I'm willing to go step in someone else's shoes and look at the world through their eyes for a moment and go, okay, what do they see? Mm-hmm. Oh, I get it. Yeah, I could see that. All right, maybe I need to adjust my way of thinking, but this whole... So I don't relate to what's going on. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't get what they're about. And it's them. It's that they're, because... I mean, they're coming from a matrix of being created.
Yeah.
They all share the same thing. Mm-hmm. You know?
Yeah, it's just... it's really saddening, honestly.
Well,
to see that... People just can't open their ideas, their minds to different ideas.
But they're the ones of different ideas. How can someone who's transgender have a closed mind? Beyond me. Mm-hmm. But the most of the in every moment of my sobriety, there's been a transgender person going through a sexual reorientation in my peripheral that I know personally. Yeah. They're not crazed. They're not promoting this nonsense. Mm-hmm. Do you know who's promoting this nonsense?
Who?
White female housewives.
Yeah.
I would say is the general demographic of social unrest, dude.
Yeah, and it's also rampant on the college campuses. Rampant.
Rampant.
So yeah, the day after Trump gave his speech to Congress a couple weeks ago, mm-hmm. the campus was covered in chalk with all anti-racists, no fascists, no racists.
But people don't know what fascists even are, man.
No.
That's the hottest. They're using a term they don't understand. Mm-hmm. It's for those who are, beware, if you can tell me I'm wrong because you're the poli-sci guy. Fascism is the merger of state and corporate interests into the government.
Yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. Which would be what we've had under Obama, which we had under Clinton, mm-hmm. which we had under Bush before him.
Yeah, and where all these people were nowhere to be found.
Yeah, where were you then?
Yeah. Where were all these people when Obama turned Libya into like a Stone Age...
Stone
Age National Park.
The Libya thing bums me out to no level, because most people... Libya's the lens. Mm-hmm. If you can look at the Libya lens, right... You can see what's really going on. You had basically a second world nation mm-hmm. that was educated, where they were making vast sums of money off their oil. Mm-hmm. Muammar, forget what Muammar it was to you. He was returning the capital back into the country, into the infrastructure. Libya was a fully developed country, running water, electricity. Mm-hmm. People were given homes. Yeah. There was no homelessness in Libya.
Free university,
free travel abroad, mm-hmm. free go get cultured. But what Muammar did, which got him killed and got his country rebelized, was he was going to switch to the African dinar and make a gold-backed currency that was interest-free. And even to the end, he was like, dude, I'll come in. Don't destroy the country.
Yeah.
I mean, he was willing to surrender himself as long as they didn't destroy Libya. Mm-hmm. You want to talk about white guilt? Everyone in the Western world should be ashamed at Libya. Should hold your head down low, man, at what happened to Libya, man.
I remember exactly when that started. I was actually out skating around. And I was just looking at my phone, go on Twitter, see what's going on in the world. French jets have bombed Libya. And I was literally just like, mind blown, stunned. Like, what are you doing? Why is this happening? And then, as you say, all these people now that are jumping up and down screaming about Trump had nothing to say. Absolutely nothing to say back then.
Well, that's the irony. I mean, how do you... All right, we're back. My phone got too hot, dude. So we gotta change the angle here. Just roll with us for 1 second, peeps. All right, shoot. Let's try it. We're trying.
There we go.
All right, we're in the shade, man. We're back. Phone got too hot, dude. We're back. Yeah, technology, dude. So we were about Libya. You mm-hmm. were skating around.
Yeah, so I think Syria is actually probably even worse than Libya. So if you look at Libya, it was actually, at least it was a state actor going against another state actor, right? So it was two countries technically at war.
Mm-hmm.
Syria, the West was straight up supporting and funding terrorism in another country.
Yeah.
There's no other way of putting it than that. That's what they were doing, and I would say that's even worse than Libya. And again, where were all the people that are now jumping up and down screaming about Trump? They're nowhere to be found.
Well, then,
when you go back and look at Syria, they weren't there protesting, they weren't saying anything.
Well, you know, we were, that's the thing. I mean, you look at, they say that the beginning of the apocalypse starts in Syria, according to Damascus, according to the Bible, man. So once Damascus is rubbleized, dude, like, better hope you're right with God, dude. But you look at that again. There's another second world nation
mm-hmm.
that had infrastructure that was pro woman, pro education.
All religions getting along.
Everyone getting along. And what happens? So basically, like, heads up, if you're a country out there and you're pro woman and you're pro religions getting along, you're going to get bombed by the United States and the Vatican and NATO. Are there any of you left? No. Putin, watch out, Vlad. They're coming for you, dog.
You better watch out.
I thought the interesting thing, Vladimir stayed off the radar screen since the inauguration.
Yeah, he's been pretty quiet, yeah.
He's been real quiet, dude.
Yeah. They were definitely hoping for Trump. Definitely. So...
Well, you got it. The guy doesn't want. The guy wants good relations. Doesn't want war. Wants a prosperous economy. Why wouldn't you want Trump to be elected?
Exactly.
I mean, Hillary Clinton was going, "We're gonna start war with you guys."
Yeah, quite literally everything that went wrong in Hillary's campaign, every little thing, the Russians did it.
That's crazy.
The Russians are responsible. We need to get the Russians.
Well, that's the thing. The dual universe is there's this thing of like you lost. Because you're close-minded. Mm-hmm. Well, that's the interesting thing. They do it. They've done a big thing about it is why they lost is because they've made everybody not want to say that they were going to vote for Trump. See, I didn't care. I'll vote for Trump. I thought he was a fool anyhow. And I'm not a big Trump guy, but I voted for him because I'm a huge anti-establishment, anti-status quo. Mm-hmm. So you look at Trump, right? I look at Trump, man, and I go, there's still chemtrailing, man.
Yep.
There's still... I said early on is he's part of it, dude.
Mm-hmm.
I think he's a magnet to get all the people like us, like true liberals, to get for him so they can... Like, I won't sign... Like, I keep constantly get signed things. Like, the voter rolls might come back to bite us in the ass, man, if the true totalitarians get a hold of the thing. But I think your average American is so sick of a corrupt government. They're like, dude, let's put the guy from The Apprentice in there, dude.
Yeah. I mean, if you just look at how he was treated by the mainstream media and how he still is treated by the mainstream media, that tells you everything you need to know that they did not want him to win at all. And if you go look at banking didn't want Donald Trump to win either.
She was a Goldman Sachs.
Yeah.
It's interesting.
Make banking great again. Well,
what's been proven, I think, is that people truly want America to fail. They truly are hoping America fails. Like, you're anti... Like, I was an anti-Obama guy from Jump Street, right? Yet, I wanted him to pull it off. Like, I was... Like, he was the president. Like, come on, dude. Like, pull it off, man. Yeah. Like, I wasn't... Like, I didn't want him to, like, fail. I wanted him to actually prove everybody wrong.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think. I need some power. Uh-oh.
All right.
What did I do? Did I just reverse it?
Oh, there we go.
We're figuring this out, dude. It's live, dude. It's unedited,
yeah,
dude. It's
what
the live.
When you go live. Yeah.
So, yeah, man, I trip out on that whole wanting the nation to fail to prove Trump an asshole. I don't get that, man.
Yeah. You just did a video on that, right?
Oh, yeah.
So I completely agree. Why would you root for somebody to fail? It doesn't make any sense. Surely you would at least want him to do good. Like, you could at least maybe in some small corner of your mind, you could think he might be able to do something good.
Dude.
But these people can't even do that.
No. And the irony is, you know, like, I made a video about the guy, the EPA recently.
Mm-hmm.
And people are all like, they're all like about the EPA, but the EPA is not about them. Like, the EPA signed off on glyphosate.
Mm-hmm.
The Environmental Protection Agency said your food supply is allowed to be poisoned by Monsanto. Yeah, okay. And so I look at the EPA. I go, that's the regime under Obama was didn't lift a finger to stop fracking, didn't say a word about Fukushima. Like, apparently Fukushima's fine, though they can't send in a titanium robot that doesn't melt down. So there's obviously a problem going on the other side of the Pacific. That might not affect you if you live in Kansas,
mm-hmm.
but it's definitely something to worry about here on the West Coast. And then the EPA didn't do anything about Flint, Michigan, the lead in the water, the fluoride in the drinking water, the fracking. So the EPA, dude, like, yeah, you guys, everybody who's bitching and moaning, they're deassembling the EPA. Why weren't you up the EPA's ass the last 16 years, dude?
Yeah.
That's what I don't get is, I mean, you're 25. I've been battling the government since I was 25.
Mm-hmm.
For almost 25 years, man. And I put my money where my mouth is so I can say what I want to say. I ran for city council twice.
Yeah.
But I used a huge lefty environmental tree hugger when I lived in Portland, Oregon for a long time, man. Like, I used to battle city councils and hang out and call congressmen and have meetings with them. Mm-hmm. Like, America's an open access system.
Right, yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, I was able to get a hold of Senator Ron Wyden and go fucking talk to him about my issue.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, the doors aren't closed.
Yeah, absolutely not.
So to sit and bitch and moan because Trump got elected isn't the real problem, because Trump's not the problem.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Exactly.
It's Paul Ryan and the Rhino Republicans that are the problem, dude. If you guys are worried about the country, dude, be worried about the people sitting in Congress.
Yeah, so the best tweet, in my opinion, that Trump ever sent out was about Lindsey Graham and John McCain. And he said,
those dudes.
Perhaps you guys should sit down and stop trying to create World War III every other day. Which is exactly what they do. John McCain photographed in Syria with the rebels, also known as terrorists trying to overthrow a country.
How does everyone not wrap their head around that the traitors in this country are the Nancy Pelosi's, the Maxine Waters, the John McCain's?
I mean, you've seen the Maxine Waters clip, right? She thinks Russia's at war with Korea.
Maxine Waters is crazy. She's from California. She's the California elected politicians are insane. I live in California, dude. Yeah, in my town, if you say you voted for Trump, dude, they will fucking tar and feather you, dude.
Yeah.
I don't care. Because if you've been watching, there was this dude in, you'll find this interesting. And there was this viewer who was like, you voted for Trump. And he saw me in town. It's like, I'm not going to talk. He sent me a tirade. I'm not going to talk to you. You voted for Trump. This. I go, dude, you've been watching my channel for how long?
Exactly.
And you don't know. Like, I've articulated why I had to pick the poison. Because you know what? The hardest thing you'll ever do in a free country is pick a shitty politician, dude.
Mm-hmm.
Is to be involved in the system. And no, you know who the biggest victims in this country are? The perpetrators of why you didn't get the person you wanted elected was the 270 million people who didn't vote.
Mm-hmm.
270 million people didn't fucking vote, dude.
Yeah.
What do you think about that from political science point of view?
It's ridiculous, to be honest.
Right?
Like, how do you expect anything to change if you're just going to sit there and not do anything? But then you want to jump up and down and scream as soon as somebody that you don't like or you've heard is apparently a bad person. but you don't want to go out and vote for somebody else, or you don't want to run for office yourself. So you run for city council twice, right?
Twice.
I ran for parliament 2 years ago.
Yeah, you did. I remember. How'd that go?
That was fun. Yeah.
It's fun, right?
Yeah.
You get to be a stakeholder in the game.
Mm-hmm.
You get to meet a lot of cool people.
Yep.
And you get some contacts that you would never get any other way.
Yep, exactly.
So you ran for parliament, and it's different over there with the campaign money and stuff. There isn't any in there, right? Or there's a stipend that you're only allowed to spend X, or...
I think that didn't really matter for me, to be honest, because I didn't have that much to spend anyways. But how you get on the ballot is different, so you don't have to run around collecting signatures like you do here. You just pay a £500 fee,
okay,
which is about $650. So I was able to crowdfund that.
Okay.
And then I crowdfunded another £400, which is about $500. And I produced 43,000 leaflets, which I got sent out to all the properties in the district.
Okay.
And that was like my main campaign thing. And they have this really cool system where the post office will send out one piece of election material for each candidate for free, which is a pretty cool system to be able to get your message out.
So you get like one free mail out.
Yeah. So if I was to do it again, I would use that system to produce like a more in-depth piece of material.
Gotcha.
I just used a little
How many votes did you get?
I was expecting about 50. I managed to get just over 200.
Good for you, man.
Yeah, so I was super happy with it. It was a good experience. I'll be able to say I did it for the rest of my
life. How much did the person who won, how many votes did they get?
Thousands.
Well, that's the irony. We live, the mayor just got reelected, Garcetti, dude. And he got 250,000.
There's a flyer.
There's the flyer right there, dude.
Yeah.
What have you done to be involved today besides bitching and moaning? See, that's the thing. It's like, you know, that's why I ran.
Yeah.
Because I was like, dude, at least I can talk smack.
Mm-hmm.
It gives me the, right? You can say what you want now.
Yeah.
Right? Because you went and did it, dude.
Yeah. Went and put my platform out there.
So
the main reason I did run is because both of the main parties, the Labour Party and Conservatives, their platforms were exactly the same on all the big issues.
Sure,
so the economy and the war. Yeah, I decided to create my own platform. It was kind of Bernie Sanders-esque, with a bit more anti-war than Sanders is.
Well, I think if you look at our thing, it's like, it was ironic how close Trump and Sanders were on a lot
yep,
of things.
Exactly.
Like the auditing of the Fed, the mm-hmm. ending the Fed. Like,
ending
that's the thing is, you got to get rid of the Fed, dude.
Yeah, ending the TPP, which is gone.
TPP gone.
Undoubtedly the best thing Trump's done so far, because all those free trade deals are not free trade deals.
No, they're slave trade deals.
Yeah,
be a slave.
They reinforce industrial colonization of the third world deals is what they are.
Well, yeah, and they're terrible for the environment, yo lefties. Like, all those free trade deals are all at the expense of, like, whatever you're trying to preserve in the environment, whether it's fish in net, you know, the tuna not getting... I can't even talk about whatever, dude. Shit gets me so uptight, dude. I get so uptight about the environmental issues because everybody's gone so wrong, dude. Because
mm-hmm.
as a dude who's been involved with it, it's like the environment, it's all about water.
Right.
The water's the most...
Pretty much.
If the economy, if the world economy was based upon clean water, everything would look different.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that should be what the economy is based on, because that's the resource that's finite.
Yeah.
You know, gold, who cares, man? That's some artificial thing they came up with. Gold.
Yeah, it doesn't matter what people say about gold. It's still a value that we as humans have given it. It doesn't have any intrinsic value.
You know it, white tofu. That's an oppressor's name. But so in the UK, what about Brexit, man?
So I wasn't for Brexit. I voted against it.
You did?
Yeah.
Okay.
And the reason was I was only really seeing the kind of free trade arguments in favor of it.
Okay.
And as we just discussed, the free trade stuff is not free trade. It's just a way to screw over certain countries and improve the values and profits of certain businesses. And it's also really skewed towards anti-immigrant messaging, was a lot of what I saw. And somehow we managed to get into a situation in the UK, and also I believe somewhat to somewhat of a degree in the US, where we've forgotten that it was the bankers that got us into the crisis, and somehow we're trying to say that it's the immigrants that have caused the crisis.
Well,
the bankers have got us scot-free.
Well, the bankers got us to bomb the people. They're not immigrants. I think that's the miss. They're not immigrants. They're war refugees.
Yeah, I'm not even talking about those guys. Just like general people from Europe and things like that.
Oh, yeah. Just well, people. That's, I mean, you look at here, man, is anyone who doesn't want Mexico to be a fully thriving economy, like, you look at Mexico, right? They have more natural resources than the United States. They have more ability to be a first world nation. But what's their problem? Corruption.
Yeah.
Across the board, corruption. And you think anyone wants to leave their family and stuff to come up here and pick strawberries in America and be undocumented? See, I roll with the thing about this is being an undocumented laborer is not a benefit to them. It's basically slave labor for corporations. Yeah, all that food you're eating that was picked by the immigrants is slave labor, by the way, because they're not getting paid a fair wage, dude, at all. They're getting paid undocumented wages, dude, which means their employer isn't paying on them either into the systems.
Nope.
And so when I hear this big thing about the illegals and this and that, I'm a pro-immigration guy, but I want the people that to be protected by immigration, not victims to immigration.
Yeah, man. Exactly.
You know, so if they gotta come in, and the irony with the thing is like the wall and the thing is like, it's all about just funneling them through like, say, checkpoints so they're not crawling through the desert and all of that stuff. Let's see, we got it. We're trying to keep the battery going. I think my, do you have a cord? I think my cord sucks.
Oh, yeah, it could be the cord, yeah.
Yeah, it could be the cord. Roll with us. We're live, man. We don't know what we're doing, but we're doing it, right? So you voted against Brexit.
Yeah, but since I've been over here and seen the Trump effect, essentially, the arguments for retaining sovereignty...
It's all about.
I'm starting to make a lot more sense to me now.
Well, yeah, you guys. I mean, that's the thing. Is in the EU, right? An unelected body can fully. I think we got power going.
We're good.
I don't know, but it doesn't. It doesn't have my icon. Doesn't flip up, so I'm not really sure. Well, we're just going with it.
The cable on the battery works. So
if it goes dead, it's because we ran out of power, dude. So you've changed a little bit, because I saw it strictly as like a nationalism issue.
For me it definitely wasn't strictly that.
Because I believe in that. In my utopian perspective of it all, I don't believe in borders. I think they're artificial constructs.
Yeah, that's.
But right. I don't believe in removing borders to make things worse.
Yeah, I agree.
If the people that wanted world government and wanted a borderless world were benevolent and there wasn't an interest-bearing currency fueling the whole system, I'd go for it. Mm-hmm. I want to cruise around.
Yeah. I mean, that's one of the big things about Europe at the moment. So with the European Union, you can just go anywhere. Any country that's in the European Union, you can just travel freely through. You don't need a visa or anything like that. Just as long as you're carrying your passport, you're all good. You can just go anywhere.
Yeah.
And you can also work anywhere as well, which is really cool.
That's totally cool. It's just this weird thing is they've got everyone's. I think it's that thing is we got to shake these guys. Mm-hmm. You know, I get into the thing of like the people that are, these ideas aren't coming from, like I look at like Nigel Farage and Brexit, and the thing is like that's sort of like people like trying to throw off the shackles,
yeah,
and be like, hey, look, man, I
see it more of that now than I did.
Yeah, because I was watching that thing, I was like, dang, if these guys actually pulled this off, man, like crush the EU. Because
mm-hmm.
you know, you get into that weird where they're trying to do this global governing regions, like you know America's broken into like 10 FEMA regions and all that stuff, like mm-hmm. The one thing I'm convinced, right? I'm looking at that dude up there, man, with his pipes, dude. loading up his truck. That guy just wants to picnic with his family on the weekend, dude. Mm-hmm. I don't know. That dude's probably maybe documented, undocumented. Does it matter? He's no harm to me as long as he wants to picnic with his family.
Exactly.
But you put things between his family picnicking, dude, suddenly you got a pissed off guy.
Yep.
And that's the thing I see on a worldwide level is most people just want to raise kids, have a picnic with their family, and generally be left alone, not have a bunch of people telling them what to do, mm-hmm. make the right decisions, and yet they got a bunch of people preventing them from picnicking with their family, and they're pissed.
Yeah.
I mean, you look at a Syrian, dude, I'd be fucking livid.
Yeah, you should be.
I would be livid. I would be over here looking.
And I guarantee if you go and ask any of those people, they know exactly what happened. They know that the West was funding all these people.
For a pipeline.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what it's all about, is it's a pipeline. Mm-hmm. You want to know why Syria got destroyed? It's a pipeline. Mm-hmm. It's a pipeline. We got bad connection. Why?
Might just be the Wi-Fi signal.
I got full Wi-Fi. Yeah. That's interesting.
I think we're still rolling though.
Just keep on trucking, man.
Yeah.
I don't know, dude. Wait a minute. Oh yeah, there we go. I could put it on the iPad and see what's going on. Yo, good. All right, Joe Shear says we're good, okay. Dude. So I trip out about this whole thing, man, because I see the people that should actually be embracing where we're going actually like getting in the way of it.
Yeah, same.
Right?
And it's like you said, the Bernie supporters really have way more in common with Trump than Hillary. Like, it's unquestionable. If you supported Bernie, you should absolutely not have voted for Hillary, like, at all. Your vote should never have gone to Hillary Clinton.
Ever.
Ever, because she was pro-bank.
But what I don't get about the Bernie people, and there are a lot of them, like, dude, why are they not rioting in the streets about being blatantly robbed? Mm-hmm. Blatantly robbed.
Yeah, I mean, I spoke to someone from the Green Party on campus in Albuquerque, and he said that Bernie had been coerced into supporting Hillary. So perhaps the Democrats had something.
Well, I was that whole scummy thing he did at the DNC was slightly shady, dude. Like he could have slammed her, right? Well, of course, mm-hmm. dude. You know what they did? We're gonna kill you.
Yeah.
That's what Hillary did in the Clinton Foundation or the Clinton machine. Is they were like, we're gonna kill you if you really nuke us, Bernie. We're gonna kill you. And Bernie was like, well, you know. Seated, and I that's the weird thing. That's what makes me like question the Trump thing too. The dude should be dead by now.
Yeah, I mean, you could make that argument for sure. They definitely didn't want him in there.
Well, I cruise around, right? And sometimes, and this gets me to the holographic nature of it all, I'm not sure there's anything going on.
Right.
I'll be cruising around and I'll be like, no, only when I turn that information on is it even relevant. I look around, most people are just fucking having trouble driving around the streets of Los Angeles, dude.
Yeah, I mean, the sky hasn't fallen.
The sky has not fallen. I figured by now, like, there would have been some sort of, like, calamity. Mm-hmm. And I was listening, of all people, I was listening to Jesse James on Alex Jones the other day, right? And I was listening to him, and he was like, look, dude, if there was anything they were going to do, they would have done it. If they had any dirt on the dude, they would have used it.
Yep.
If they were going to make a move on it. So it's like, look, dude, we got Trump for the next 4 years, dude. Like, enough with the, like, it's just the way it is, dude. Mm-hmm. Like, so now what? So now what? Worst case scenario, people. Now what? We got all these new jerk-off cabinet members. His cabinet choices are...
Yeah, that's one thing I did a video on. His choice to replace General Flynn, General McMaster. So he wrote a report specifically looking at how Russia is becoming a greater threat to the U.S.
Well, how about Flynn registered as a foreign agent the other day? You didn't catch that?
No, I didn't
that Flynn's been doing the bidding of Turkey. Do you want to know what the elephant in the room that no one's getting ready for is? Fucking Erdogan in Turkey, dude.
Yeah.
Erdogan's a madman,
yeah,
dude.
Yeah, he sure is.
And he's all about rebuilding the Ottoman Empire. Do you know what that means? He's about rebuilding the Ottoman Empire. Do you know what the Ottoman Empire is, people? Most people don't, dude. It's the Islamic Caliphate, dude, on steroids, dude. Yeah. Industrialized, dude.
Yeah, go look at a map of the old Islamic Caliphates, just how big they were. They extended all the way halfway through the bottom of Spain.
Yeah.
So in Europe.
So look, I mean, they got a toehold in Germany. I mean, so they've gotten further in Sweden. I mean, Europe's lost for all intents and purposes to this thing. And if Erdogan's over there registering like his own political parties against that dude in the Netherlands, the Gilder guy, because, you know, they might break from the... I think the EU's done, which I think Erdogan sees.
Yeah.
I think Erdogan sees the EU's done, and he's like, all right, I'm going to fucking fill the vacuum, dude.
Because he was hoping to get Turkey into it.
Yeah.
Like, fully into it.
Well, you look at that weird thing Erdogan did with that, with the nuclear air base we had over there, where they surrounded when the supposed coup went down.
Mm-hmm.
Yo, shaka kind. So I look at a guy like Erdogan, and no one's talking about what Erdogan's up to, dude. And I go, he's the, you know, Russia's got their eyes on him. Like, everyone's like, what's this Erdogan clown gonna do? And then you got this thing with China down there in the South China Sea, dude. Like, who's up? Pay attention.
Yeah, so Erdogan shot down that Russian fighter jet. That had no warning given to it whatsoever. They had one surviving pilot who'd lived to tell the tale, which I don't think they were expecting. And when they eventually recovered him, yeah, he said, we didn't receive any warning that we were in Turkish airspace, that we were doing anything wrong, and they were just shot out of the sky. And then in the South China Sea, I saw earlier today, Japan is doing the biggest naval drill it's ever done with the United States in the South China Sea real soon.
Well, Trump just sent over the B-2 bombers to flex on North Korea.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I mean, it's funny, dude. People are sitting there talking about global warming, dude. And I'm like, dude, that's not even an issue.
Yeah.
It's these assholes with nukes.
Yeah.
Throwing them at each other. You want to see the globe get hot?
Yeah.
It's going to get hot, all right, dude.
Exactly.
I, that's where everyone's just gone. Like I can't... And again, as I look at it as a mass hypnosis, how do... Inside by who is the question. Well, yeah, global cool. That's why they call it climate change, dude.
Mm-hmm.
But it's funny...
when the temperature switched...
This is the irony, right? Because you, like, I listen to people bitch and moan about the new dude, the EPA doesn't believe that, and they misquoted him, by the way, because I heard the full quote on No Agenda the other day. No Agenda. I'm going to hit you in the mouth. And No Agenda. And so I heard the whole quote. He didn't say that he doesn't believe in CO2 is a trigger on the global warming thing. He's like, dude, it's science, and there needs to be more science going on. Science is an evolving sport, people. So this thing where they're like, it's just this way, that's not science, dude. That's politics and money.
CO2 is not a potent greenhouse gas.
No,
methane is like the most potent, one of the most potent. But well, you know what the most potent greenhouse gas is?
No.
Water vapor.
Yes. Yeah. Well, yeah, that traps all the heat in. The UV comes in, it gets hotter, it bounces back and forth, mm-hmm. and the whole thing. But no one's talking about the chemtrailing, dude. Like, that's...
Yeah, I think the whole climate change thing comes back to almost like people can't accept that things change. Like, people can't accept that Trump was elected. They also can't accept that the weather changes. And, like, Egypt used to be a rainforest.
Yeah. Well,
Who's to say what Los Angeles will look like in 2,000 years?
Well, this is my trip about... I firmly believe climate change is occurring. Mm. But it's because they're spraying something in the atmosphere full of barium and aluminum. And when you look at what it is, right... Have you ever checked out Operation Bluebeam?
No.
So Operation Bluebeam. The basic running theory is Operation Bluebeam is that they're creating, they're adding all this stuff to the aerosol injection. It's not chemtrail, aerosol injection in the upper atmosphere to create a plasma shield.
Right.
So that they can generate all the HARP and the all this stuff and bounce signals to create optical things. So it's going to be, their last big move is the false flag alien thing. So, and I'm convinced with the phones, right? If you look into Operation Bluebeam, people, the phone, right, knows you. It knows you. So when the holographic moment comes, the oh shit moment, it's, and the Bible talks about it, is it's this voice that comes out. It's going to be talking to everybody in their language, in their tone, about their thing.
Right.
So if you're a Christian, it's going to be, it might have Jesus. If you're the UFO guy, it'll have the UFO. If you're the dinosaur guy, it'll have the giant dinosaur. But whatever it is, it's going to kick in with your phone, and it's going to be there, because that's what they, you know, like if you look at the Tupac hologram at Coachella, and it's going to be like that, where you're like, oh, whoa, bro, and it's talking to me, man. Uh-oh, and you're gonna fucking, because you're not trained. See, I've trained myself about the 1984, right?
Yeah.
Right? How do they get fucking, what's his face? What's the gummy guy? Well, they get him, they stick the, he's afraid of rats, right?
Yeah.
Now they stick the mask on him with the rats, and he cracks. So you have to know what you're afraid of. They're going to go in. They have the ability with your thing to know what you're afraid of. And they're going to come at you because you haven't trained yourself for the flinch test. Because the way I look at it is this. Your body's going to do one of two things. It's either going to go fight or flight.
Yeah.
Fight or flight. So the fight response, they're just going to probably blow up your fucking phone and you're out.
Yeah.
I mean, the fight. And then flight, they're going to go, oh, we got this fucker, dude. If I make him into a slave, it's going to be okay. Then there's all of us who have trained, are spiritually centered. When the moment happens, we're not going to do anything.
Yeah.
We're going to have no, and I figured it all out watching The Predator.
Oh, yeah?
Remember when The Predator comes and Arnold Schwarzenegger covers himself in the mud and he hides in the fucking crack under the tree root? And his whole thing is so it doesn't pick up a signal.
Yeah,
I was like, that's what the whole thing is don't pick up a signal. Right?
Yeah. Avoid the signal.
Avoid the signal, man. So, yeah, I think there's a lot going on, dude. So back to your colonizing Mars theory. How does it look? How does it look? What happens on Mars?
Well, there are like a bunch of treaties about space. So there's more politics involved in space than you'd imagine. So initially during the Cold War, the Soviet Union in particular wanted space to be like its own national territory. So you couldn't fly satellites and things over top of it.
Sure.
But physics means that's not possible.
Sure.
So it's more of a, it's more governed in a like law of the seas kind of way.
Okay.
Where it's a common area for all people to explore and be a part of. So yeah, there's this thing called the Outer Space Treaty, and it says that anything that goes on in outer space, and specifically on another celestial body, has to be done for the benefit of greater mankind. So my question is, how do you make sure that actually happens? And if you're Elon Musk, for example, and you're the only person that can get to Mars, and you're the only person that can colonize Mars and do what you want on Mars, how is somebody going to tell you to do any different? And how are they going to be able to enforce what they tell you to do? And can we eventually, way off in the future, get into a situation where we have people fighting wars on Earth for resources, materials, land, property, essentially, on other planets? Could that be a thing?
I don't even get what the need for war is, man. Like this resource thing, it's like, it's all based upon the con job. It's not a real thing. I mean, unless someone comes to your house and is going to do harm to you, then you war them and you kill them.
Yeah.
It's that simple. That's why I believe in an armed citizenry.
Yeah, same.
You know, 100%. You're from the UK. You guys got de-armed, and what? Yep. Violent crime went up, right?
Yeah, stabbings especially.
Yeah.
It's like you don't stop crime. People just find other ways of going about it.
Nothing creepier than getting stabbed, man.
Yeah, I'd rather be shot than stabbed for sure.
I think so, dude. That's close quarters, dude.
Yeah.
You smell their breath. So, okay, this was what I was thinking about the Elon Musk with the WikiLeaks Vault 7, right?
Mm-hmm.
They know it. They have all this technology.
Right.
Right?
Yeah.
See, I mean, Elon Musk is in on it, man. I think he's part of the whole new world order, but they've made him out to be as like, oh, this dude.
He's really pissed off Lockheed and Boeing. They've had a monopoly on space launches for many, many years.
But that's old, but that's, I guess that's the thing, is like, that's a con. Because rocket launch stuff is like archaic fucking technology from the Chinese like Han Empire or something. Like rockets are primitive.
Mm-hmm.
Like it's all like, have you checked out the Nazi Bell?
Yeah.
And torsion fields and stuff?
Yeah.
Like, dude, well, I mean, once you start looking at torsion fields, you're like, dude, rocket ships are a fucking joke. Like, a joke.
Yeah, it is a joke when you think, like you say, that technology's from all the way back then.
Yeah, the Nazis were working on it.
Yeah, where the Nazis were working on it, and we're still using it today. Like, we're still using jets to fly around in that take us forever to get to places, because we're not looking at exploring these new technologies in any serious manner.
All right, as a poli sci guy, how come there hasn't been a big war about territory in the Antarctic?
There's a treaty on Antarctic.
I know, but they can get along down there?
Yeah, it's probably just because of how harsh the environment is.
But there's tons of resources. Yeah, he is a genius at getting government money, that's for sure.
Mm-hmm.
No, so that's what I mean is so if you look at the Antarctic, the seventh continent, dude, mm-hmm. all divvied up into pie-shaped slices for various countries, tons of resources there,
mm-hmm.
all sorts of stuff going on there.
Yeah.
Right? It's proof that the stuff going on the other six continents is bullshit.
Yeah.
I guess is my point.
Yeah, that's a good way of putting it.
You know? Like, apparently everyone can come to terms with what's going on in Antarctica and respect everyone down mm-hmm. there. So...
Yeah, maybe it is, like I said, just how harsh the environment is.
Well, like, there's been...
It makes it almost physically impossible to try.
There's been a lot of interesting people going down there and up to the North Pole and stuff, dude.
Yeah.
So that's something to be watching, right?
Mm-hmm.
Right.
I mean, surely as technology develops, it will be easier for us to go to places like that and perhaps exploit their resources.
Exploit the resources. We must exploit the resources. Mm-hmm. I'm a big, like, extractivism to me is just stupid.
It's really primitive.
It's very primitive.
Yeah.
Because, again, as I go, all of the need to extract any resources disappears with the localized energy field. You don't need lithium to make batteries.
Mm-hmm.
You don't need fossil fuels. You don't need to frack things, dude. Like...
Yeah, like, even if you can't get to, like, the Tesla stuff, like, for me, we should be pursuing nuclear more than we are. It's the most efficient way of generating power. If you do it right, it can be really safe.
Yeah, but that's the thing, is, like, it's efficient... On the front end, but on the back end, it's a disaster, dude. Like, almost all nuclear reactors are past their age. The life mm-hmm. expectancy on a nuclear reactor is like, what, 30 years? Most of them are like 45 years old now.
Yeah.
There's no managing the cleanup on it. Like, they have not figured out what to do with nuclear waste yet.
Nope.
You look at Fukushima, could be the extinction level event. I'm a big, like, nukes tech. Again, nuclear technology is based upon transmission lines, dude.
Yeah, I see what you're saying with that. Yeah.
It's null. But you look at like these nuclear powered like submarines and ships and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty efficient on a localized level, except they don't know what to do with the waste.
Yeah,
a waste is radioactive for hundreds of thousands of years.
Mm-hmm.
Bad.
Yeah.
I think it's this weird thing of like, I just think that we are such a short-term species we've forgotten. Like, you know, we don't need to do this.
Yeah. There are perhaps other ways of going about it. But yeah, I think we need to look into that technology and try and actually figure it out so it does work and so we can manage the waste. I mean, we've got enough brains trying to figure that stuff out. You know, I saw a really interesting article a while back saying that essentially today's Einsteins and Teslas, do you know what they're doing today? They're trying to make an app in Silicon Valley.
Yeah.
And they're trying to get clicks on ads on their app.
Yeah.
That's what today's Einsteins are working on, how to get the most clicks on an ad on an app.
Well, because science has been defunded.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, science has now been put through like this weird... Most scientists can't go explore science because they're being controlled by the universities, man.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's all grant money.
Yeah.
So, like, all the great people who would invent things can't get any money.
Mm-hmm.
So, they're like, fuck, I'm going to make an app. Maybe I'll raise a bunch of money so I can go explore something. But let me not go explore alternative fuel technologies because I'll get killed.
Yeah.
Yeah, the roll call of people who've invented, like... The hydrogen powered cars and all this like 0 point fuel stuff have been murdered, man.
Mm-hmm.
And we as a society just take it. I don't. And I get it. They got the attachment to the spacesuit thing going on.
Yeah, they passed something in the UK recently that said any government funding going to universities couldn't be used for anything that would be critical of what the government's doing. So if your research is critical to what the government is doing.
Well, there's
the government
full
wouldn't send you funding for it.
Well, there's full censorship over in the UK.
Yeah,
have you listened to Max Kaiser talk about how they he says anything about certain like hedge funds and stuff? They people come pounding on his door like during the show, and they're like, "No, you can't talk about that, babe."
Mm-hmm.
And then I've been watching those people that are about those girls who are trying to stop the pedophilia and stuff, fully censored. I mean, that's what it gets down to is what is the real energy. For me, I look at the true energy as metaphysical.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's what they're trying to steal. Like, they got us all over here talking about fuel cells and Tesla technology and going to Mars and this and that. But yet what they really want to do is take your God-given metaphysical beingness, your spiritual beingness, and keep it down here continually in these lower dimensional skin suits, keep you here, and then that's what they're powering themselves with. They keep you in fear. Because you look at almost all wars, all start on a very specific day for like satanic and religious like days, know, and they're big bloodletting ceremonies. So I think that we as people have underestimated what really is going on here, because it's dark, man.
Yeah.
Who wants to go think about that crap all day long?
Yeah, I think that's like kind of what we were saying earlier about people are kind of in their own bubble and they don't want to break out of their own bubble because of that, because it is so dark and they don't really want to face the reality of what is actually going on in the world, so they'd rather sit and watch TV or do whatever else.
And the TV helps them to sit there and watch it, you know? That's the irony.
Yeah.
The TV's given back just as much as it's taken.
Mm-hmm.
Magic Mental Mondays, I uploaded. Yeah, you know it, baby. So, that's for sure. And so, no, that's the weird thing. It's like, I think when you wake up, the first stage of waking up is the horrifying truth, right? Isn't that what Neo has to do?
Yeah.
And when Neo wakes up, the horrifying truth.
Mm-hmm.
And then you begin to realize that you can go to the light and do anything you want. But the first thing you have to realize is you're stuck in the matrix.
Yeah.
And that's some deep responsibility, man. Like, so why, like, the thing is, like, I don't believe in, like, waking people up. I've come to that whole conclusion with, you know, Morpheus talks about it, you know?
Yeah.
Like, you know, we don't generally wake people up at a certain point because they can't handle it.
Mm-hmm.
They crack. And I find that's the truth is, like, you just got to let people wake up on their own.
Yeah.
And people who are awake are awake. You're awake. You're 25, right? Like, how'd you wake up?
I kind of started when I was in school. So probably like middle school for you guys.
Okay.
But yeah, I grew up in the 9/11 era.
Okay.
So I remember coming home from school when I was 10 years old, and I watched the second plane hit the towers live as it happened on TV.
Yep, everybody did.
Mm-hmm. And so from there on out, I grew up in a world that was going to war constantly. And it was also the time of the growth of the internet.
Yep.
So I was also exposed to the alternative theories and all that stuff.
Yeah.
On 9/11 and the wars. And I'd always kind of been critical of things, like even way before even 9/11 happened, when I was a little kid, I remember being critical of the royal family. Like, why can't I be a prince?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, right.
So I guess I kind of always had that mindset of questioning, but it all came together in a perfect storm in like the mid-2000s.
Question, everything, man.
Yeah. Well, it's always been on that since.
Well, I was listening to some dudes talking about the 9/11 thing, and like why people just can't even deal with it is because if you wake up to that thing and you go there, it means that the whole system's corrupt, and evil beyond just any rational thought, and that you are like caught in this like machine, and that's just some deep, dark, scary stuff, man. Mm-hmm. So it's better to believe that 9/11 was just 19 hijackers, dude, and like call it good, and what's building 7, dude?
Yeah, and one guy who couldn't fly a Cessna managed to rotate a plane around an almost impossible angle into the Pentagon.
When you look at, well, that's the thing, is that whole airplane thing in the Pentagon's just, well, you find out that that's where all the budget paperworks were, mm-hmm. for the trillions of dollars that Cheney was talking about. Yeah, the audit money, like, mm-hmm. but all the paperwork's gone. And then all the gold that was missing from the 9/11, and just, have you checked out where did the buildings go?
Probably.
It's the girl who's like that. What was going on was an energy weapon.
Yeah, I have seen that.
That she's about that there was a category 5 hurricane just off the coast that no one talks about.
Oh, that I haven't seen.
Dude, go look at the weather map of the day 9/11, dude. About 150 miles or less. Off the coast, there's a Category 5 hurricane.
Huh.
Being steered away because they were... So her whole thing is that she looks into it, and where do the buildings go? Because the mass and the stuff, like, where do they go? Mm-hmm. And her thing is basically what they used was Tesla technology.
Okay.
And dematerialized the buildings and liquefied them or vaporized them. Mm-hmm. And it's very interesting stuff.
Yeah, I mean, Building 7, like you just mentioned briefly, they just watched that building collapse. It just goes. It wasn't hit by a plane.
Well, but the fire caused the girder to melt, dude. Yeah. Of course.
And it caused every floor to fall exactly at the same
time.
Well,
let's not, but let's not forget what was in Building 7.
Yeah, all the government offices.
All the government offices.
Intelligence agencies.
Yeah, dude. Let's not forget about that. No, that's the thing is no, there's not one part of the 9/11 story that holds water.
No, none of it.
First of all,
none of it.
From the stand down orders to the planes, the jet fighters being way up north and all the game exercises going. You had all the same stuff with the 7/7, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Is a bunch of exercises going on. Nothing adds up.
Yeah, the guy from the, it's like a private security firm, I guess,
admitted
that does exercises. He actually is on the radio and he says, "Oh, it's surprising. Today we were drilling these scenarios of bombings at exactly the same train stations at exactly the same times."
Well, that's what's been odd to me is like almost every sort of mass event in my lifetime has been tied to something. There's been a drill going on.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you look at all of them, there's always a drill going on.
Mm-hmm.
And it's always turns out there's someone on psychotropic drugs, dude. It's all the same stuff, dude.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's what's really going on. I mean, that's the thing. It's like, I think we know, but we don't.
Yeah.
I don't think we really know how dark it is.
Yeah.
And the power we have. You look, David Icke's one of your countrymen.
Yeah.
David Icke breaks it all down.
Yeah, I went to see him at Wembley.
You did?
Yeah.
You were at Wembley,
I was in the front row.
No way. I'm a big David Icke fan, dude. You're a fan too, I gather.
Yeah, I don't get into like all the super reptilian stuff and all that. But what I take away from what he says is that what is going on in the world is so bad that it might as well be from another planet.
Exactly.
Trying to attack us. So if you look at it like that, it makes sense. You don't have to go the full way and say the Queen's a reptile or whatever else. But you can understand what he's saying on that level, where he says that it might as well be aliens from another planet doing this, because it's the only thing that kind of makes sense. Like, why are you destroying your own planet, your own species?
Well, he gets really into it, and it was the big thing about how he talks about how that there it's these interdimensional creatures that are using these surrogate human beings to feed off energy, which is fear, which is the lower dimensional energy. Mm-hmm. If you're in a state of fear, which there was 9/11, you look at 9/11 with the Twin Towers and the Pillars of Hercules and the 9/11 date, which was the American call for help on the phone and all this kind of stuff, and the fear that it generated worldwide, and that lower frequency energy that was generated that day, mm-hmm. who knows what we were really being used for and powering.
Yeah.
And I think that's where David Icke, because if you can listen to his thing, I mean, you know, is he's a true believer in humans have the ability to break free.
Yeah.
We just need to bypass the lower dimensional box. But the first thing we got to do is do what we're doing, is discuss the lower dimensional box mm-hmm. in order to figure out what it is.
Yeah.
You can't get out of the box if you don't know you're in a box.
Yeah.
Where are the walls of the box? Where's the roof of the box? Where's the side of the box? I remember this Twilight Zone, you know, Twilight Zone mm-hmm. show. And it one that explains it perfectly. It's like an Indian, a soldier, a girl, like a robot, and they're in this like round room, right? And they're trying to climb the wall, right? They're trying to climb the wall to get out and mm-hmm. get to the top. And eventually the one dude gets out, and there's a banging going on the whole time. Bang, bang, bang. And he gets out and he falls in the snow, and it turns out he's at a donation. There's a bunch of toys, mm-hmm. and they're in a donation can at a Salvation Army, and the banging's the girl with the gal, and she picks him up out of the snow and throws him back in. And it's this thing of, like, what's the box? It's Socrates' cave, right?
Yeah.
It really is. Mm-hmm. And we're being flooded with so many, like, Socrates' cave was just the light from the back of the entrance, right? Yeah. And they were chained to the thing.
On the wall.
But now we have light from all directions and all frequencies and sound and all this stuff
all the time as well, nonstop.
Nonstop, dude. So what are we really seeing, man? Mm-hmm. I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, a lot of what he says is it definitely opens your mind up to possibilities.
You got to be willing to go there to look at it.
And it's like we were saying earlier, you just need to be willing to have an open mind.
The 60-40 ratio, man. Mm-hmm. But you know, like, David Icke's been proven right over again. David Icke was proven right about this whole pedophile thing.
Yeah, the child abuse stuff.
Yeah, I mean, that's just...
Yeah, he was writing about it for years, and he was never sued.
Well, and they was always calling him crazy. Mm-hmm. As someone said, it all appears to be a flat plane to me. So one of the theories that I checked out a lot was that this is really just two-dimensional.
What do you mean?
This experience.
Right.
That it's really going on in the plate, that if we're actually not moving, it's all going on in the plate, inside optic plate inside of our thing, and it's really just a two-dimensional plane that appears to be three-dimensional because mm-hmm. we actually think that we're moving and flowing through it, but we're actually like spiritual beings in a like stationary, multi-dimensional spot, condensing ourselves into this like smaller reality, man.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Up at the... Observatory, the Griffith Observatory. They have the Foucault pendulum, Foucault compass or something, and that's supposed to prove that the Earth.
Oh, the one that moves around,
And it knocks over a peg every 7 minutes, and it proves that the Earth is it that the Earth's spinning or that we're spinning around the Sun? It proves one of those two things. I can't remember which one exactly.
Sure.
Yeah, interesting.
I try to get I went and had some dude break down the whole flat Earth thing, which is like the new, and I'm like, I don't know, dude.
Yeah, I think that's one of those things that might be planted out there to make the rest of the stuff that people talk about seem ridiculous.
Well, that's my 60-40 thing. Mm-hmm. As you as a human being with an art able to articulate things, you're supposed to look at things with a critical mind.
Yep.
Like,
and it really doesn't take much to do that.
But question everything. Mm-hmm. I question my fundamentals, dude. Mm-hmm. like my spiritual essences all the time and be like, well, I don't know. Like, okay, I gotta come to that place again.
Yeah.
Like, okay, yeah, like Jesus Christ is my personal savior, dude. That's not some willy-nilly like thing I picked up because I'm a white guy in North America, dude. Like, like I went deconstructed
it. Yeah, you actually figured it out for yourself.
Yeah, I had to go find it by deconstructing it again. Mm-hmm. And I do that all the time. Like, you know, like I'm one of those. Like, you got to look at things with the critical eye and take it with a grain of salt and not lose your sense of humor.
Yeah.
Definitely. Right? That's the gig, dude. Yep. Don't lose your sense of humor about all of this, man. It's madness.
Yeah, complete madness.
But what's really going on? Like, we've been sitting here for an hour talking to our iPhones, dude. And there's we're on Lincoln Boulevard. We're at Lincoln and Marine, if you want to Google it, dude, in front of the Starbucks here, because they got a Wi-Fi signal. And there's nothing going on except a bunch of people driving up and down the street, man.
Exactly.
Guaranteed, there's every demographics crossed the street.
Yep.
Driven down the street since we've...
Multiple times.
Whether it's guaranteed they're a Syrian... war refugee drove down the thing, the one everyone's afraid of, dude. And see, I don't want to live in fear.
Nope.
I see where they're generating the fear, though. I get it, man.
And like, I apparently was, so on my trip here to Los Angeles, apparently I've been staying in a bad part of town. I haven't noticed that at all. Like, I just go about my business. I'm strolling around, no problem.
I learned that as a skateboarder, man.
Yeah.
Is human beings are like dogs. If they sense fear, they're going to come and get you, man.
Yeah.
They sense, if you have your victim light flashing.
Yep.
Let's say it's this guy from the 60s and said the conversation never stops. Mm-hmm. That's the beauty of it all, man. Like, and eventually, you know, with the, you'll face time and turn back into dust and go back to wherever.
Yeah, maybe our space.
But, you know, yeah, so I get that whole thing is like the world's as safe and dangerous as you want it to be.
Yep, totally agree.
But I'm a big dude, don't let him in, though.
Yeah, agreed. Yeah, so you have to walk around without the victim hat on and also be prepared at the same time.
You got to be ready to kick some ass.
Yeah.
That's the thing, man. You have to. And I think that's what I see a lot of people, a lot of these people are going through. If we look at the current political climate, is you have a bunch of people that haven't come to terms with their darkness. Mm-hmm. And now they've got their reason to like let their freak flag fly. You have people that up until 3 months ago claimed they were like peaceful, nonviolent, all about peace and love and hugs and equality and stuff. And then they've got their excuse to be like, no, but this one dude, mm-hmm. I get to like let all that go, and I can be intolerant. I can talk about hate. I can dislike other people.
I can advocate violence against people.
Yeah, and so what happens is all of a sudden they've realized that, oh my God, I'm not the enlightened being that I was, because I didn't even realize that I'm a bigot. I'm a hater. I'm a violent human being. So in order to mask that all, they haven't gone the full intellectual way. Like, when you intellectually go the whole distance where their argument comes from, it ultimately always ends up in the same spot: gassing people. Mm-hmm. They're the left's argument in America right now, if they logically would follow it through, basically means putting you and I in a gas chamber and killing us.
Yeah.
Because we don't represent their idea, and in fact we're a threat to their idea because we don't buy into their idea, dude.
Mm-hmm. And that is the very definition of the fascism that they...
Yeah, they are the fascists. ...claim
that they're against. Like, there's a thing going around online at the moment. You might have seen it, like, punch a Nazi. Why are you punching anybody?
Just don't listen to them.
Exactly. Don't listen to them, or better still, come back with your own arguments about why they're wrong.
Well, it's that thing is... You need these counterweight human beings with their mm-hmm. ability to freely speak. Like, as I always say, the person you need to listen to the most is the person that you're opposed to.
Yep.
Because they're the chart. Someone just asked me about the laws of attraction and this and that. The only way someone, you can be opposed to someone is they have a charge. Mm-hmm. That's a conflicting charge, and it's part of your being. You like a white supremacist racist, or a black supremacist racist, or any sort of racist can't get a charge out of me because I refuse to acknowledge the power of their ideas.
Yeah, same.
I'm like, whatever, dude, go scream at the top of your lungs over there on the corner. But the minute you pick up a rock and you go and try to bang one of those people, and I have the right to kill you, dude.
That's when you cross the line, yeah.
That's the thing, is that's what a free society is about, is a lot of bad ideas. Mm-hmm. Like, you can have your bad idea, dude, but the minute you try to impose it upon me, I have the right to defend myself to your bad idea.
Yep, exactly.
And I think that's what we're looking at right now is... So what I get is about it is people can't affect you unless you're willing to be affected.
Yeah, that's a great way of putting it.
You know, and just like, and about the power of attraction, like here we are, two dudes of like mind sitting in a car on Lincoln Boulevard talking about our perception of the world. Mm-hmm. I don't know. It doesn't have to be any crazier than that.
No,
right?
Definitely not.
That's pretty... I look at it as it's all pretty Buck Rogers-ish, man. Like, look at this sci-fi thing, dude.
For me, I very much believe in that law of attraction.
Oh, yeah.
Like, I'm making things happen that you want to happen. It's like, I always have wanted to come and live in the US. So, I guess you can say I put it out there into the universe that I wanted to do that. And I found a path of steps that I could take to make it happen. Followed the steps, and here I am.
Well, yeah, what most people don't get with the laws of attraction is you got to show up and mm-hmm. walk the path.
Yeah, you definitely have to.
It doesn't, like, it's not a click of your fingers. Mm-hmm. Like, you got to put it out there and allow it to morph, too.
Yeah.
Sometimes to get to where you want to go, you have to go way over there.
Yeah, you have to take the action yourself.
Well, you got to go where you don't want to go sometimes.
Yep.
Like, that's... I was listening to someone talk about that. They were like, yeah, you can... Most people don't want to do the uncomfortable part of the story. Mm-hmm. The hard part, which is to go where you don't think you should be going because you're like, I get jammed up about it all the time, man. Because you lose track of it. You're like, oh, I want to put this. But then... And you also forget, like, what you really want. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, what do you want?
Yeah.
Like, what is it that you want? Because you can have your... There's been so many stories of the dude who wanted the Ferrari, gets the Ferrari, and then the boulder falls. There was one guy in Malibu, this was like 10, 15 years ago. Some dude who struck it rich with like his tech thing, got his Ferrari, always wanted his Ferrari. He's driving through Malibu Canyon, and he was going through a tunnel, and a rock fell through the sunroof of his Ferrari and took his head off.
Wow.
You can get what you want.
Yeah.
But do you know what you want?
Yeah, that's also true. You need to figure out what you do really want.
Because everything comes with the balance of yin and yang. I think that's what we're experiencing now is if you're not ready for it to be balanced out, like nothing comes without a counterweight. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like there's always an opposite and equal reaction.
Yeah.
So you got to be ready for the universal equivalent of that. Like, okay, yeah, you wanted to come and live in America, here you are, but mm-hmm. it comes with sacrifices.
Yep.
You know what I mean? You might have had to leave your puppy dog behind, or mm-hmm. some girl you loved, or
that actually happened while I was here.
Okay.
So yeah, met a girl and that all kind of crashed and burned. There you go.
That's it. That's what happens. Mm-hmm. Well, Stuart, I think that's it, huh?
Yeah, we can wrap it up there for sure.
We're good, dude. You got an hour, and I got 63 on this one. Plus, I think it was a half. We did good, dude.
Yeah, I think we went for like half hour before this one even started.
Yeah, so. Dude, we did it. We went live, man. So, Stuart J. Hooper.
Mm-hmm. Facebook, Twitter, YouTube.
Let keep an eye on this cat, dude, because he's gonna get his PhD. And okay. Final wrap it up. So what are you going to do with this PhD and thesis about the space program? What's your goal? What's your plan, man? What's your plan, dude?
Well, career-wise, I'm not 100% sure. I'll probably do the professor thing for a while.
I want to be a professor.
But I don't see myself doing that forever.
Okay.
But I really like writing.
Okay.
So maybe get into the whole book writing scene. But overall, I'd really like to try and hopefully push our species forward in a positive direction.
Yeah.
That's what I'd like to do.
Yeah. Well, yeah, that's...
Make a positive impact. I need
people to get in there and look under the hood.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like, I don't think it's any different than a car engine.
Yeah.
You know?
Just a system.
It's just a system, dude.
You can find what's wrong with it and fix it.
Yeah. Maybe. Maybe, dude.
If you got the right skills.
If you got, yeah, who knows?
And the right tools.
Who knows, man? It's all just a thought anyhow, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's all just a dream. All right, so that's the deal. Dude, I'm super stoked we spent some time together.
Yeah, it's awesome.
That's just good stuff. So how much longer are you in the States for?
Years. Years and years.
Years?
Yeah, it'd be like at least 4.5 more years.
All right, they want some book recommendations.
I've been reading None Dare Call It Conspiracy by Gary Allen.
Gary Allen.
The book that apparently woke Alex Jones up, and that's...
Okay.
It's only like 100 or so pages, but yeah.
I just got turned on to this guy, Lewis Mumford. Lewis Mumford, it's called The Machine.
Okay.
And he wrote it in the 30s. And it's about what we're talking about. It's a political stuff. But I guess it's very well written. I just was listening to it. And so I would recommend the No Agenda podcast on Final Note, dude. A lot of good information going on. That's where I heard about this Lewis Mumford guy. And there you go.
Yeah, check out 21stcenturywire.com. I used to write news articles for them. It's an alternative news website, and they kind of keep it super balanced. Try to do as little political bias as possible. Just tell the story as it is.
Yeah, that's what these guys deconstructing the news. Well, it's everything's... That's where most people don't get. It's everything's coming from an agenda.
Yep.
Even the alternatives. We've seen a lot. Look. On the final note, a lot of the people that I viewed as alternative media have hitched their wagon so radically to the Trump nonsense that they're just as questionable as the lamestream media, man.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's about reporting. It's not about making you feel comfortable with your ideology or them feeling comfortable. You want reporters to be uncomfortable and be like, oh, wow, man, like,
yep.
It's not what I thought it was. Damn. Or maybe figure out it was what you thought it was, but you weren't ready for it. I don't know. All right, Stuart, where can I take you, man? All right, we're out, you guys. Dude, that's the first big long live one.
On the live stream.
No.
Fireball.